today. As I'm sure you know, John Negroponte was recently appointed as the first director of intelligence. And like Bolton, he too has credentials. In the 1980s, during the first reign of the current incumbents in Washington, at that time he was the ambassador to Honduras, where he presided over the world's largest CIA station. It was not because of Honduras is so significant in world affairs, but it was because he was supervising the camps in which the U.S. terror army was trained and armed for its war against Nicaragua, which was no small matter. The country was virtually destroyed. Well, if Nicaragua had adopted our norms, what it would have done is respond by terror attacks within the United States in self-defense, in this case, authentic self-defense. But it didn't. Instead, Nicaragua pursued the peaceful means that are required by international law. It brought the U.S. attack to the World Court. Nicaragua's case was presented by a distinguished Harvard University lawyer, Professor Abe Chase. The court bent over backwards to accommodate Washington. It eliminated a large part of the case that Chase presented for an interesting reason. The reason was that when the United States had accepted World Court jurisdiction in 1946, it entered a reservation excluding the United States from any multilateral treaties, notably the UN Charter, which bans the unauthorized use of force as criminal, in fact, the supreme international crime, in the words of the Nuremberg Tribunal, but of course only when others do it. The court, therefore, restricted itself to bilateral U.S.-Nicaragua treaties and customary international law, but even on those very narrow grounds, it charged Washington with, technical words, were unlawful use of force, which in lay terms just means international terrorism, ordered Washington to terminate the crimes and pay substantial reparations, which would go far beyond overcoming the debts that are strangling the country that were accrued during the U.S. terror war. The Security Council of the United Nations affirmed the World Court judgment in two resolutions, vetoed by the United States, hence basically unreported and unknown. The U.S. immediately escalated the attack, leaving the country utterly wrecked, with a death toll that in per capita equivalent terms for us would be 2.5 million dead in the United States. That's more than all U.S. deaths in all wars in its history, including civil war. Nicaragua has so declined that 60% of children under two are suffering from severe malnutrition, probable permanent brain damage. All of this is so deep in the memory hole in the elite intellectual culture that, you know, it's scarcely known. If you want to see some examples, take the editorials in the Boston Globe in the last few days, which are puzzling about anti-American attitudes in Nicaragua after its failed revolution, failed for some unknown reason. There are several relevant conclusions from all of this. One is it's another illustration of Washington's self-exemption from international law, including humanitarian law, based on universal principles of human rights. In this case, as many others, with very grim human consequences. And it also reveals, again, the self-exemption of the elite intellectual culture from responsibility for our crimes. It's a conclusion reinforced by the fact that Washington has just appointed a leading condemned international terrorist to the position of world's leading anti-terrorist czar. All of this is quite normal. Orwell wouldn't have known whether to laugh or weep. In fact, the U.S. has refused to ratify most of the enabling conventions that were passed by the General Assembly to implement the Universal Declaration, or more accurately, it's accepted none of them, to my knowledge, because the few cases that have been ratified are accompanied by reservations that exclude the United States, just like the Genocide Convention and others. That, incidentally, includes the anti-torture conventions that have stirred up a lot of recent debate. There's an important article on the matter of the Journal of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences by a distinguished constitutional law specialist, Sanford Levinson. He joined most others in condemning the Bush Justice Department, including the recently appointed Attorney General, for having articulated, I'm quoting Levinson, for having articulated a view of presidential authority that is all too close to the power that Schmidt was willing to accord his own Führer. He's referring to Carl Schmitt, who was the leading philosopher of law during the Nazi period, and whom Levinson describes as the true eminence grise of the Bush administration. Nevertheless, Levinson offers some defense of the Justice Department authorization of torture. He points out that when the Senate ratified the UN Convention against Torture and Other Cruel, Inhuman, and Degrading Treatment and Punishment, quoting Levinson, it offered one what one might call a more interrogator-friendly definition of torture than that adopted by the UN negotiators. And the unilateral US definition does go some way towards permitting the practices that have recently enraged the world and elicited much highly critical commentary here. Well, it's depressingly easy to continue, but I'll end with one last observation about the current scene. A few days ago, I gave a talk at the Hope Church in downtown Boston. It was a meeting called by CRISPAS to commemorate the 25th anniversary of the assassination of Archbishop Romero of El Salvador, a voice for the voiceless, as he was called, murdered by security forces backed by the United States, many of them graduates of the famous School for the Americas. Romero was assassinated while he was performing mass, shortly after having sent President Carter an eloquent letter pleading with him not to send aid to the brutal military junta in El Salvador, which will sharpen the repression that has been unleashed against the people's organizations fighting to defend their most fundamental human rights. Well, that was ignored. State terror increased after the assassination, always with US support. The hideous decade, not just there, ended with the murder of six leading Latin American intellectuals, Jesuit priests, by an elite US armed and trained battalion that had already compiled a shocking record of atrocities, mostly the usual victims, peasants, working people, priests and lay workers, in fact, anyone connected even loosely to the people's organizations fighting to defend their most fundamental human rights. CRISPAS was one of the first of the mostly church-based organizations that were formed after the Romero assassination to support those who are fighting to defend their most fundamental human rights. And they did it in ways that are really of historical significance. They broke entirely new paths in many centuries of Western violence. They did it by going to live with the victims, to help them, in the hope that a white face might protect them from the wrath of the US-backed state terrorist forces. That's never happened before. I had the privilege that night, a couple days ago, of sharing the platform with Mirna Perla. She's a Salvadoran Supreme Court justice who's the widow of Herbert Anaya and is attempting to continue his work under terrible conditions. Anaya was the leading human rights activist in El Salvador. He was imprisoned and tortured by the U.S.-imposed government and then assassinated by the same hands that murdered the archbishop and the leading Jesuit intellectuals, along with tens of thousands of the usual victims and comparable stories in the neighboring countries and elsewhere. Well, in a society that valued its freedom, it would be completely unnecessary to recount any of this, because it would be taught in schools and it would be well known to everyone. And we would now be preparing to commemorate the 25th anniversary of the assassination of the voice for the voiceless, just as we would have commemorated a few months ago the 15th anniversary of the assassination of six leading intellectuals, if anything like that had remotely like that had happened in Eastern Europe in those years, we would certainly know about it. And in fact, we would be reacting the same way right now to the continuing atrocities by the military forces armed and trained by Washington. For example, in Colombia, which has been the leading human rights violator in the hemisphere for many years, and throughout all that period has been the leading recipient of US military aid and training. It happens to be a very well-established correlation, not insignificant. Again, it would be well known to everyone in a free society or a society that valued its freedom. Last year, Colombia apparently maintained its record of killing more labor activists than the rest of the world combined. A few weeks ago, the military broke into the most important of the towns that had declared themselves zones of peace, separating themselves from the